Welcome to lecture series on digital electronics under EPG Pathshala. This module is dedicated to understand about the memories. Memory is basically a device which is capable of storing the binary information. In almost all electronic gadgets, we require a memory for storing the information. Computer prefers to store either programs as well as data in memory. Whenever we talk about computer, there are two types of memories which are normally preferred. The first one is called as a primary memory, and the second one is the secondary memories. Secondary memories are having huge capacity as compared to primary memories. Primary memories are usually semiconductor memories. Usually we use some kind of RAMs or ROMs, whereas in case of secondary memories, we use either magnetic tapes, magnetic disk, hard disk or floppy disk. We can even go for CDs, DVDs, and maybe even the external flash drives. Whereas when we talk about the primary memories, we classify semiconductor memories into two types, RAMs and ROMs. ROMs and RAMs both are having random access property. They can access any memory location in the same period. So whenever we talk about random access memory, even the ROM has the same property, so that's why we always try to prefer RAM as read-write memory and ROM as read-only memory. There are variety of technologies available in ROMs. We can talk about maskable ROM, then we can have PROM, programmable ROMs, or we can have erasable programmable, that is EPROM, or electrically erasable ROMs. Along with that, when we talk about RAMs, we have two basic types, static and dynamic RAMs. Static RAMs, they require some kind of 4 to 6 devices for storing the information. So their packaging density is less as compared to DRAMs. When we talk about DRAMs, usually we require hardly a single transistor and a capacitor for storing the information. But there are certain relative advantages and disadvantages. Dynamic RAM requires some kind of refresh cycle, whereas static RAM is some kind of volatile memory. Both RAMs and ROMs could be identified based on their characteristics. So when we talk about basic characteristics of the memory, we include the storage capacity, we include writeability, whether it is programmable once or many times, whether it is volatile or non-volatile, and so on. There are several parameters that we need to discuss along with the memories. So in this module, we'll focus it on different characteristics of memories and types of memories. Let us begin with the learning objectives of the module. Initially, the basic memory characteristics will be studied. Second, to know the organization of semiconductor memories. Third, to understand the difference between static and dynamic RAMs. Lastly, to get familiar with different types of ROMs. Now let us begin the journey into the world of semiconductor memories. Let us get familiar with memory. Memory refers to the physical devices used to store programs or data on a temporary or permanent basis. The basic flip-flop is considered to be 1-bit storage cell or a memory. It is possible to construct n-bit memory using shift register. Shift register is used for storage as well as shift. In this session, we are dealing with only semiconductor memories. Advantages of semiconductor memories are small size, no moving parts, and low power requirements as compared to the magnetic memories. In a semiconductor memory, each bit of binary data is stored in a tiny circuit called memory cell, consisting of one or more transistors. Each storage element can store 0 or 1. Now let us look at how the memory is organized. Memory is usually organized as an array of blocks called cells. Let us consider three simple ways of arrangement of cells. Cells can be organized as 8 into 1 array, that is 8 rows and 1 column, or 8 into 4, that is 8 rows and 4 columns, or 8 by 8 array, that is 8 rows and 8 columns. It is also important to note that each row is labeled by a number. This number indicates the address of the memory cell. The binary which is stored in the cell is referred to as data. The location of a cell in a memory array is called its address. The addresses of a cell in one dimensional array of 8 different cells can be uniquely given from 0 to 7. In general, address refers to a number that identifies the location of a word in a memory. Each word stored in a memory has a unique address. Addresses are always written as binary number or hexadecimal numbers. Here, it is important to note that memory location specified by the memory address has a capability to store only 1-bit information. Total 8 bits are stored in the memory. This is a 8x4 memory with 8 storage locations with memory addresses from 0 to 7, but the storage capacity of each memory location is 4 bits. Thus, this type of memory device can store 32 bits. This is a 8x8 memory with storage locations with memory addresses from 0 to 7, but the storage capacity of each memory location is 8 bits. Thus, this type of memory can store 64 bits in all. Memory word refers to a group of bits in a memory. Nibble refers to a group of 4 bits. Byte refers to a group of bits. Word sizes typically ranges from 4 to 64. Now let's look at the memory capacity. It refers to how many bits can be stored in a memory device. For example, a memory can store 256 by 4 bit words, then total memory capacity of 1024 by 1 bits, that is 1 kilobits. Let us represent the symbol of the memory. Any memory is referred to as M by N memory. Here M indicates number of memory locations and N indicates word size, that is the capacity of each location to store the data. For example, 1024 by 8 bits, here M is equal to 1024 and N is 8 bits. The memory capacity is 1 kilobyte. Every memory has address lines to access M memory locations. The number of address lines are 2^k is equal to M, where k indicates number of address lines. Address bus is unidirectional. Further, the memory has N data lines to read from or to write the data to memory locations. Data lines or bus are usually bidirectional for read-write memory. A memory IC has read bar, write bar, and CS bar control signals. The read bar control signal enables the output buffers and data from selected memory location is loaded onto the output lines. CS bar must be activated for any read or write operation of memory. The write bar control signal enables the input buffer and the data from input data lines are loaded into the selected memory location. Many memory ICs have a common data bus for input and output and common control signals. Memories are always defined as M by N, where M is the number of storage locations and N is the size of each storage location. Each storage location has unique address in binary. The block diagram of generalized memory indicates three major components and three signals. Internal hardware contains an address decoder, 1-bit memory cells organized in rows and columns, and input/output buffers. For M memory locations, K address lines are required to enable one location where M is equal to 2^k. These K address lines are decoded by the decoder and one of the memory location is selected. The decoder has a capacity to decode k lines to 2 raised to k lines. The memory has m into n memory cells. There are k address lines, namely A0, A1, A2 up to AK minus 1 to access these m different locations. Each storage location has n data lines, namely D0, D1, D2 up to Dn. The read/write bar represents read and write signals and treated as control signals. Let us consider the example of 1K by 8 memory. It has 1024 by 8 bits. That is equal to 8192 basic cells. It requires 10 address lines A0 to A9 and 8 data lines D0 to D7. Memory write operation is performed when some data is to be written to a selected memory location. During the write operation, the address of the selected memory location is loaded on address lines. This address is decoded by the address decoder to enable the memory location. The CS bar and write bar signals will go low once address appears on the address bus, as shown in the figure. As both control signals are low, the input buffer is enabled. The data byte available on the data bus is stored in the selected memory location. When a new data byte is written into memory location pointed by the address, the current byte at that location is overwritten. In memory write cycle, following operations are performed. First, the address of desired memory location is loaded on the address lines first. Second, the chip select signal goes low. Third, the word or byte to be stored is loaded on the data input lines. And fourth, write command signal is applied to the write control signal and the data is returned at that memory location. Let us discuss different terms associated with memory write cycle. Write cycle time, it is the minimum amount of time for which the valid address is present for writing the data in the memory location. It is TWC. Let us talk about now write pulse time, TW. It is the minimum duration of the write pulse. Address setup time is TSA. It is the minimum amount of time from the beginning of a valid until the write signal goes low for setting up the address. Data setup time. It is the minimum amount of time for which the data is valid before the write pulse ends. And last, data hold time, that is TWH. It is a minimum amount of time for which the data is valid after the write pulse ends. In the read operation of the memory, the data from the selected memory location is taken and made available on the data lines. During the read operation, the address of the location is specified on address lines. The address is further decoded to enable the memory location. The CS bar and read bar signals go low. This enables the output buffer and the data from selected memory location will be loaded on the data lines as shown in figure. For memory read operation, following sequence of operations are performed. First, the address of desired memory location is loaded on the address lines. Second, the chip select signal goes low. Third, the memory read signal is applied to read bar and the data is loaded from the memory to the output lines. There are few parameters associated with memory read operation. These are read cycle time, that is TRC. It is the minimum amount of time for which the valid address is present for reading the data from memory location. Access time, TAQ. It is the time required to to access the data from a memory location. It is the maximum time from the start of valid address of the read cycle to the availability of the valid data at the outputs. Output enable access time, TGQ. It is a maximum delay time between the start of read pulse and the availability of the valid data at the data outputs. Chip enable access time, TEQ. It is the maximum delay time between the chip select signal and the availability of the valid data output. Memory chips are organized into a number of locations within the IC. Each location can hold 1 bit, 4 bits, 8 bits, or even 16 bits, depending on how it is designed internally. If the number of locations are limited, then one dimensional array of memory is used with only one address decoder. As the memory addressable capacity increases, then the memory is organized in two dimensions. In such a case, separate row and column decoders are used as shown here. Read and write signals will decide the nature of memory operation. Semiconductor memories are classified based on different parameters which are related to number of technologies and types of memories that have emerged. First, data size. Memory devices are classified according to the data size. It can be bit addressable, byte addressable, or word addressable. Second, functionality. Semiconductor memories are classified based on the functionality of the device, whether it is read-only, that is ROM, or read-write memory, that is RAM. Third, access method. Memories can also be categorized into way the memories are accessed, like sequential or random access, or in serial or parallel way. Example, first in, first out, last in, first out, RAMs, etc. Fourth, input-output architecture. Memories can be classified depending upon how many input and output ports available for data transfer, single or multi-port architecture. Fifth, applications. Memory can be categorized according to the application, like main memory or secondary memory or embedded memory. Sixth, storage ability. Memory can be categorized based on storage ability, that is volatile or non-volatile. In volatile memory like SRAM and DRAM, they lose their contents once the power supply is turned off, whereas non-volatile memory like ROM and EEPROM can retain their data even after the power is removed. There are two major categories of semiconductor memories, ROM and RAM. ROM, that is read-only memory, is a type of memory in which data is stored permanently or semi-permanently. Data can be read from the ROM, but there is no write operation, just similar to RAM. Like RAM, the ROM is also having random access property. ROM is classified into four categories: MROM, PROM, EEPROM, or E2PROM. RAM stands for random access memory. It is a memory in which all memory locations are accessible in the same amount of time for read as well as write operations. All RAMs have both read and write ability. Hence, RAM is also popularly known as read-write memory. There are two types of RAMs: static RAM, that is SRAM, and dynamic RAM, that is DRAM. The random access memory, RAM, is also referred to as read-write memory because with RAM, it is possible to read or write the data from or into the memory with the same speed. The read-write memory is volatile, and therefore the data stored in the memory will be lost whenever the power is switched off. RAM is classified as static RAM and dynamic RAM. Static RAM is further classified into two types: asynchronous SRAM and synchronous SRAM. Dynamic RAM can further be classified into five different types, namely fast page mode DRAM, extended data output DRAM, burst EDORAM, synchronous DRAM and double data rate DRAM. In static RAM, the contents of memory locations do not change with time and the data is stored in terms of voltages. The basic element of SRAM is a flip-flop or a latch, which is a bistable device and capable of storing 1-bit information. The cells of SRAM are constructed using bipolar or MOS transistors. SRAM cell requires 6 transistors per cell configured as inverters. The basic types of SRAMs are asynchronous and synchronous SRAM with burst feature. In asynchronous SRAM, the operation is not synchronized with the system clock. In a synchronous SRAM, the operation is synchronized with the system clock. There are few advantages of SRAM. The access time is less, hence static RAM is faster. Refresh cycle is not required. Third, power consumption is low, and the fourth one, the cost is also low. Disadvantages: SRAM requires 6 transistors, hence requires more chip area per bit, thus the packaging density is low. The basic element of DRAM is a single transistor and a capacitor. The data is stored in terms of electrical charge on capacitor. These memory devices make use of MOS capacitor fabricated on a chip. It allows very large memory arrays to be constructed on small IC. Therefore, the packaging density of DRAM is highest. The MOS capacitor cannot hold the stored charge over a long period of time. It must be refreshed, meaning recharged, at least 1000 times within a second. It requires additional refresh circuit, hence the total cost of DRAM is higher. DRAM consumes more power. The DRAMs are further classified into 5 different categories. The different categories of DRAMs are fast page mode DRAM, that is FPM DRAM, extended data output DRAM, which is popularly known as EDO DRAM. The next one is the burst EDO DRAM, that is BEDO DRAM, synchronous DRAM, that is SDRAM, and double data RAM, that is DDR DRAM. FPM DRAM is fast page mode, which allows fast successive read and write operation at each address in a selected row. FPM DRAM fast page mode allows fast successive read and write operation at each address in a selected row. A row address is loaded first and then sequential column address. FPM saves time over pure random access because in FPM, row address is specified only once for access to several successive columns. EDO DRAM, the extended data output DRAM, is also called as hyper page mode DRAM. In this case, next column address can be accessed before the external system accepts the current valid data. This process is used for speeding up the access time. BEDO DRAM, the burst extended data output DRAM, is just similar to EDO DRAM with burst capability to speed up the access time. SDRAM, the synchronous DRAM, is synchronized with the system clock. DDR DRAM, in double data rate DRAM, the data is transferred at both rising as well as falling edge of the clock. Let us now compare SRAM with DRAM. The basic elements of SRAM is flip-flop consisting of 6 transistors, whereas DRAM requires only 1 transistor and a capacitor. In SRAM, data is stored in terms of high or low voltage, whereas in DRAM, electric charge is stored in MOS capacitor. time required to access SRAM is less and more for DRAM. SRAM is faster than DRAM. DRAM requires refresh circuit and SRAM do not require refreshing. Power consumption of SRAM is low, whereas DRAM consumes more power. Cost of SRAM is low as compared to DRAM. Let us now discuss the ROM. Read-only memory is designed to perform only read operation and used to store the programs that do not require any modifications. Read-only memory is also a random access memory. It is a non-volatile and therefore retains its contents even after the power is removed. ROMs are classified as mask ROM, programmable ROM, erasable programmable ROM, electrically erasable PROM, and so on. Let us now talk about MROM. It is permanently programmed during the manufacturing process. Depending upon the application, manufacturer programs the ROM IC. Once it is programmed, the memory contents cannot be changed. This requires the binary data must be specified by the designer and then pass it on to the manufacturer for mask programming. The mask program is required to set 0 or 1 at proper memory cells. MROM is normally used in smart toys, video games, computers, and consumer products. PROM is one-time programmable ROM. It can be programmed electrically by the user but cannot be reprogrammed. Hence, the binary information must be error-free before programming. In PROM IC, the manufacturer provides a connection or a fuse at every interconnection of a grid of address and data lines. Initially, rows and columns are connected through a fusible link. Therefore, the information stored in all memory locations has all bits zero. At the time of manufacturing, the fuse material can be either nichrome or polycrystalline silicon. The fusible link can be melted or the fuse can be blown off by passing a large amount of current through the fuse. If the fuse link is intact, binary number 0 is stored. If a fuse is blown off, then binary number 1 is stored in the memory. EEPROM is a semi-permanent programmable memory. It can be erased and reprogrammed. The structure of basic memory cell contains an additional floating gate within the MOS structure. The basic principle of operation is to accumulate charge on the gate using external high voltage during programming and while erasing, illuminate the memory by ultraviolet light. The data bits are represented by the presence or absence of a stored charge. The initial value of the memory cells may be all zeros or all ones. User can program the EEPROM with a special programmer known as EEPROM programmer. All the contents of memory can be erased by exposing the chip for a duration of 15 to 20 minutes. The EEPROM should be covered with an opaque sticker to protect the memory from unwanted exposure to UV light. As the EEPROM can be reprogrammed, the memory is suitable for the monitor program of microcomputers. The disadvantage of EEPROM is that we cannot erase selective information. The entire information is erased because of UV light. E2 PROM is a semi-permanent memory. It can be erased electrically. The basic device used in fabrication is MOS device. Data is stored as a charge or no charge on insulated layer or an insulated floating gate on the device. Regular 5 volt is sufficient to move the charge across the thin barrier in either direction for programming or erasing. The main advantage of E2 PROM over the other ROMs is that it allows selective memory erasing. In E2 PROM, it is possible to erase the contents of a memory at the individual register level rather than erasing all the information. E2 PROM can be erased or programmed with a device right in the circuit, also known as in-circuit programming. It requires less time for erasing as compared to EEPROM. It is a non-volatile RAM. It is a combination of static RAM and electrically erasable PROM, that is E2 PROM, in the same chip. The static RAM and E2 PROM are twin or mirror memory structures of each other. When power is on, it functions as normal RAM. When power is switched off, it saves the stored data in the E2 PROM. The complete contents of the RAM are transferred in parallel to the E2 PROM is less than few milliseconds. When the power is turned on, the complete contents of E2 PROM is transferred back into the RAM. Thus, E2 PROM is used for temporary data storage during power failure. The important data such as time, date, system configuration are normally stored in the CMOS static RAM or NVRAM. Memory devices are characterized by various parameters like storage capacity, non-volatility, in-system programming or erasing, speed, and cost effectiveness. All these parameters are applicable only to flash memory as compared to RAM and ROMs. Flash memory is a high-density read-write memory which is non-volatile. These memory devices are used in place of floppy or hard disk in PCs. The storage cell consists of a single floating gate MOS transistor. A binary 0 or 1 is stored as a charge or absence of charge on floating gate. A 0 is stored when there is more charge and 1 is stored when there is less charge or no charge. Let us now talk about commercially available RAMs and ROMs. There are numerous vendors supplying RAMs and ROMs. Typical memories are indicated here. SRAMs are available right from 1K by 4 to 32K by 8 and higher. Similarly, DRAMs are available right from 4K by 1 to 256K by 1. Usually, memory banks are formed to get higher storage capacity. ROMs are available in different versions from 2K by 8 to 64K by 8 and even higher. Today, we use 8GB to 64GB SDRAM cards for our mobile phones. Let us summarize few important points regarding the memories. In this module, we have seen that there are several basic characteristics those must be seen while selecting the memory. The first one is about the storage capacity. When we talk about the storage capacity, how much information could be recorded into the memory, we usually use either units of kilobytes, megabytes, or today we usually talk in terms of gigabytes. Similarly, when we talk about writeability, there are several memory devices which could be programmed only once. So naturally, we can write the information only once, and in certain cases, we can write as many times as you want. So that is an erasable programmable ROM. When we talk about RAMs, which is basically a read-write memory, we can read as well as write the information. In addition to the basic read and write signal, there is a chip-enabled signal which is required in case of ROM as well as RAM. So number of addressable locations are decided by the address lines, and the size or the capability of the addressable location is decided by the data lines. So when we talk about the generic memory, we have to talk in terms of three basic signals. The first one is address lines, which allows you to define the size of the memory. The second, we can talk about data lines, wherein you can decide the amount of data that could be stored per location. And the third one is set of control lines, which could be read, write, and chip select. So these signals are normally required while accessing the memory. When we talk about RAM, we have to consider either static or dynamic RAM. Static RAM usually requires 4 to 6 transistors. The packaging density is very low, whereas the DRAM is having higher packaging density. But the only problem is it is slower and it requires refresh cycle. So looking at their relative advantages and disadvantages, we can select the memories for variety of applications. The next module is dedicated to use these memory devices as programmable logic devices. We are going to learn about some kind of applications wherein the ROM or RAM can be used as PLD. Thank you.